So, this is a video about carnivorous plants. Because Borneo is well known for pitcher plants, some of which can get quite large. But before I go look at some out in the jungle, I wanted to rewatch a classic horror, though it's kind of a comedy, I guess, film, The Little Shop of Horrors. No, not the one based on the Broadway musical. The one before all that, the old black and white one, because it's free. Let it roll. What is happening? This man is eating flowers?
You only moved this out of your way so you could breathe.
Ow! What little plant? Nom nom nom.
What happened? How come you woke up? Blood? You like blood?
Oh, look how cute!
Oh, you must be kidding.
I'm hungry.
I don't care. Poor what plant. You are.
He thinks he's going crazy.
I want food.
I like this plant voice. It just sounds grouchy.
I'm hungry.
Who would you like to have tonight?
You look fat enough.
Wow, the plant's
rude.
Now
we got a talking plant. We got one that makes with smart cracks.
You gotta reach in there. You know, inside the two giant halves. Well, the plant got a live victim. Yeah, plant didn't want the gun. Wait, the plant has hypnotism powers now?
No time.
Oh no, their faces and paper mache.
Seymour!
I didn't mean it.
Oh no.
Few places are as famous for carnivorous plants as Mt Kinabalu in Borneo. This is the world of Nepenthes pitchers, such as these examples growing in the botanical gardens, though these are tiny compared to the rare giants of the mountain. Here are some preserved specimens of those compared to my hand. These are big enough to predate not only on insects, but on rats. Pitcher plants lure their prey with sweet smells and sugary nectar. The animal then feeds along the lid, which holds a very thin layer of water, which causes the insect, or again, depending on the size of the pitcher, rat, to lose footing by hydroplaning, and the prey then falls into a pool of liquid made by the plant within the pitcher structure and prevented from climbing out by a slick waxy surface. The liquid is a cocktail of complex chemicals that ensure prey remain trapped, are digested after they drown, along with preventing the growth of bacteria and fungi. Near the bottom of the pitcher are glands that absorb the nutrients the plant needs to thrive in low-nutrient soils, which is the whole reason these plants have become carnivorous. This is a way to get nutrients where there are few in the poor soils they grow on, such as peat, sand, or as an epiphyte high on a tree branch, where there is no soil at all. So, what are pitcher plants up here eating? Well, let's try our best to peer into the murky depths and see. Honestly, it's very hard to tell what is down there. The liquid is murky and dark, but here we go. Looks like this pitcher is full of ants, so I guess that's partially what's on the menu for a pitcher plant. This tasty soup of partially digested insects, however, is very tempting for thieves. Nepenthes pitcher plants have a wide diversity of what is known as infauna, animals that live inside pitchers. Some of these, Nepenthibionts, are specialized to live in these little pools of water, including several species of mosquito, whose larvae live in the digestive juices and munch on the plant's victims. Nepenthophiles are less specialized, but include spiders that grab drowning flies, and tiny crabs entering the pitcher for lunch. Some pitcher plants even have symbiotic relationships with mammals that use them as convenient forest toilets. Some of Kinabalu's pitchers have a relationship with tree shrews that come to feed on the nectar and poop while visiting. Others in the lowlands have little bats roosting on the lid, and so guano fills the pitcher. These marvels of nature, however, face many threats in the modern world. Continued habitat loss, because apparently humans can find a way to do agriculture or build housing in the bogs or eroding hillsides these plants often grow on. Then, the climate is shifting, exposing these plants to droughts and fire regimens they're not adapted to, along with being interesting plants that draw the attention of unscrupulous horticulturists who want to be their own and are not concerned if they purchase poached specimens. Did you know the Venus flytrap, perhaps the most famous carnivorous plant, is actually vulnerable to extinction? This is because of all three of these threats. Their swamps are becoming suburbs, they need fire to maintain the bogs they live in, and despite being cultivated in captivity in large numbers, there is still a market for wild specimens, and there are criminal flytrap poaching rings. Entire populations of rare carnivorous plants have been poached within days of them being discovered. Nepenthes are particularly at risk, nearly a third of all species being classified as threatened and vulnerable to poachers, and for 27 species of Nepenthes, illegal collection is the primary threat to their survival. Unfortunately, among carnivorous plant enthusiasts, illegally collected specimens is for the most part a tolerated open secret. By not cracking down on this criminal behavior, organizations and communities based around the horticulture of these species are complicit in the extinction of these plants in the wild, where they belong, so they can fill their ecological niche. Anyway, here's a list of the species at the most risk from overcollecting. So if you are a carnivorous plant enthusiast, please do not purchase these unless you know for a fact they are cultivated in captivity. Hopefully, we can give these interesting organisms a break and allow them to continue to thrive in the ecosystems they evolved in. Thank you for watching this video on this series on misconceptions about organisms in old B movies. Next time, I will be taking on my arachnophobia and handling a large tarantula out in the desert night. What am I getting myself into for the views?